Tonight you'll hear five speakers. Andrew Genuso, Jennifer Wegman, Josue Quinones, Daniel Pressman, and Aaron Washburn. Now, to start off tonight, we have Andrew Genuso, who's a junior here at BU. He's the president of the Education Club, and today he'll be talking about his goals on becoming a math teacher in the future. Now, his speech will be about the goals that he has and the journey he's taken to get there. So without further ado, please welcome Andrew Genuso with a fighting chance.
Thank you very much for us.
Thank you, Ashley, for organizing this wonderful event and the Education Minor Steering Committee. And thank you all for being here tonight. The reason why I titled my speech A Fighting Chance is because I was like, well, I need to submit some kind of title, but I'm not going to talk about that really much at all. So please bear with me while I just kind of wing it. Right? But I am going to talk about my journey in education. And it has not always been a good one. Actually, in high school, I graduated with the most detentions and in-school suspensions out of anyone in my grade. But at the same time, I graduated seventh in my class. So I'm going to talk a little bit about why that happened and a little bit about why this matters. Growing up, I got bullied a lot. I got bullied because I grew up in a predominantly white town, and very clearly, I am not white. On the outside. I was actually adopted by Italians, and I am far more Italian than I am Korean. But that being said, not most people are able to see things like that. They are not able to grab the concepts of diversity to the extent to which that many of you are able to do today. And that's one of our roles as teachers, to push that and to help students, our students and the future, see that. But that isn't the focus of my talk. The focus of my talk is that education is a means that we can use to develop the next generation and develop our futures. Now, when I got bullied, I got into a lot of fights, and they were not always good. And it wasn't always just shoving matches in the schoolyard. It was brutal. I still got scars on my knuckles from some of them. And this is not something that I'm proud of. Actually, on the contrary, when I became a martial arts instructor in ninth grade, I made it my sole duty to remind my students that no matter what you learn here, no matter what you do on these mats, this does not transcend out of the dojo, out of the dojo, out of this class, because people do not fight in school. That's not why you're there. You're there to get an education, you're there to learn, and you're not going to do that by getting stuck in detention. Now, while I was in detention, and this isn't the case for everyone, I was able to get done most of my schoolwork, 3 weeks ahead of time, because that's being in school suspension, and they don't really have much for you to do there. But I also got to see a lot of other students who didn't feel that same way, and they didn't feel the same care that I had felt for my parents, or my teachers, or my instructors in martial arts. And I'm not telling this to you to impress you. I'm telling this to impress upon you how important it is as educators to show that you care about your students. So, when you think about it, whether you're teaching math, or poetry, or martial arts, those are all skills. And yes, they're transferable, but they're not the same kind of transferable skills like grit or resilience, or the ability to take a joke or laugh at oneself, or the ability to stand up for oneself when someone's making a cruel or rude joke at you. And those are the things that people remember. People are always talking about the best lessons in school aren't the lessons that you learn about math or the lessons you learn about science. They're the lessons that you're going to carry with you for the rest of your life. Now, that's why it's important, because we're not teaching math. We're teaching character development. Those things are a means that we're going to teach character development. And those things that people take with them, they're never going to forget. Now, it's really easy to say that, oh yeah, I'm going to go be a great teacher, and I'm going to change the world. And you know what? A lot of people go into the profession, and I haven't even yet, and they get defeated by the idea that, well, these students may not all like me. But it's not about having everyone like you, and it's not even about having everyone respect you. It's about respecting yourself and respecting the vision that you want to pass on to the next generation. Now, when I taught Taekwondo, I kicked ass. And I had all my students kick ass. And they trained really hard. And one of the things that differentiated them from the other students that they fought in competitions was that no matter what I threw at them, they never gave up. But it wasn't about being a tough instructor. It was about showing them that no matter what I'm going to put in front of you, you're going to be able to get through it. Because I'm going to be tough, but the world out there is a lot tougher than I am. And it's not going to say, good job after class. It's going to say, I'm going to be a lot tougher tomorrow. And a lot of students and a lot of kids these days see that. They don't see the light at the end of the tunnel. They just see the amounts of work piling up on them. And a lot of times as college kids, we see that too. We see the next assignment, or the assignments that we have to do next week or next month, and then finals at the end of it. And it never seems to lighten up. But our role as educators is to be that light. Bruce Lee is a very famous martial artist. But the reason why people like him isn't because he kicked ass. The reason people like him is because he had an insane philosophical view of the world. He was a philosopher first and foremost. And what he talked about most, more than anything else, more than beating other people up, or more than teaching self-discipline through martial arts, is that he taught that you should love your opponent, and you should love yourself. Because ultimately, that's what transcends through teaching a school, teaching a class. It's about teaching love. Love's what makes a Subaru a Subaru. But it's also what makes a classroom a classroom. It's what makes a student and not a rabble-rouser. It's what makes a teacher and not a dictator. And it's what's going to change the rest of human history. But as educators, as future educators, as close to retiring educators, now I'm just joking. Okay, I don't mind throwing a couple punches here and there. But making sure that you love what you do and that you love your students makes all the difference. Because at the end of the day, they're going to see right through you if you don't care about them. But if you do, it makes their whole world a better place. Thank you very much. So does anyone have any questions for that?
No.
One more round of applause for Andrew, everybody. I'm not making you do that. This is my TA in my class. I'm not making you do that for that reason. Up next is Jennifer Whiteman. Now, Jennifer is a professor in the Health and Wellness Department here at BU. Her speech today will focus on the benefits of examining both sides of an argument. Now, by doing this, she will talk about a community systems conceptual model that her and her colleagues designed in the CCPA PhD program. Professor Wegman will talk about how her teaching philosophy, and show how the model will be used in education. So here is, here is Jennifer Wegman talking about perspectives and the importance of learning both sides of an issue.
Today. And I think it's actually really interesting that I go after you, Andrew, because somebody who is getting ready to go into the teaching field followed by somebody who's been in the teaching field for 21 years. So I have been teaching on campus for the last two decades, plus one. And I'm actually so inspired to see so many of you who have an interest and a passion to go into education, because I know, not only being an educator myself, but also being a parent, how important it is that we have teachers who feel exactly the same way that you feel, Andrew, who understand that we have to teach a whole person, that it takes love, and it takes compassion, and it takes toughness to to make sure that all children are educated, that all children leave with opportunities to go on to college or to do whatever it is that their heart desires. And as I was listening to you teach, or listening to your talk, I was thinking about how I felt when I first got into the teaching profession. And as I was sitting there, I'm like, I think I want to change what I want to talk about when I get up here. But I'm not going to. I'm going to stick to what I'm doing. I'm actually involved in a lot of research right now that has a lot that I'm looking at. I'm doing stress. I'm researching stress. I'm looking at the way that we think about stress mindset. And a lot of what I'm doing is tied into growth mindset. So if you haven't learned about this yet in education, you will. I promise you will. And exactly what I see coming from you is a growth mindset. And I'm so excited for your future students, and I'm so excited for your future students. Because when we have educators who believe, one, in the power of education, but two, believe that each child, each student can achieve, can learn, can succeed. I mean, how many times could your teachers have said, you know, what a loser, he's in detention all the time, and completely have given up on you? You could have given up on yourself, and you didn't, and here you are getting ready to go into that actual field. Okay, so can you keep me on track, because I talk a lot. So give me like a little couple minute warning and tell me to get off when I need to get off. Okay, so I see some former students out there, and I know that you probably have heard, and I know for sure Sam has even seen this before, and I know that a lot of you are going to hear some of the same things that you hear from me all the time in the classroom. Well, one of the things that I believe as an educator, and I've come to believe, and I believe as a human being, is that we need to understand both sides of an issue. And until we do, I don't think that we can make a legitimate, valid argument for what we believe until we understand what the other side is. So a lot of what I teach is health and health-related. But a lot of what I teach has a lot to do with social issues. And so it would be really easy for me, because I have my own thoughts and I have my own opinions and I have my own biases, just like you all will too when you step into the classroom, for me to get up there and to teach any kind of issue from my own perspective. But that doesn't do a service to my students, because what I learned very quickly when I stepped into the classroom, especially because you're the population in which I teach, is that you don't all think the same way I do. My students don't have all the same thoughts and opinions that I do, and neither will yours. Whether you're teaching kindergartners, or you're teaching seniors, or you're in higher education, everybody, every student, is going to come from a different place. They're going to come from a different perspective, they're going to have different truths, they're going to have different cognitions, they're going to have different motivations, and we need to respect that, but we also need to foster that. And so what I see my job is to offer both sides of the story. So regardless of what I'm talking about, and I tell my students all the time, you don't have to believe everything that I say. You can debate, we can argue, we can discuss. All of those things I think are really, really healthy. But what I think is important, and why I believe that this is important, because if I have a stance on an issue, and I understand both sides, I can make some really intelligent statements and arguments, and I can debate in an intelligent way. I can think critically about why I feel the way that I feel. And that's what I want for all of my students. So when I started working on my PhD, I literally have been a student almost my entire life. So I graduated from Binghamton University. So I used to be one of you a long time ago. I have a bachelor's degree in biology. I have a master's degree through, at the time, it's not even here anymore. It was like human development and education was one department a long time ago. And I have my master's through that. And now I'm working on my PhD. So I'm immersed in finishing my coursework and starting my research. In the beginning of my studies, I took a community systems class, and one of the things that we kind of dove into is like what drives social actions within communities. So one of the things that we developed, and I can't even take credit for this entire model, because this was a semester-long project that my entire class worked on. So I'm part of this, but these are not all my ideas. These ideas, however, are rooted in theory and they're evidence-based. So if you want to read my paper that I wrote about this, I can certainly give you all that, but who wants to be, you know, given all those boring details? So I can give you examples, too, of how I use this, but I think that this model works in so many contexts. So I'm like looking out there and I see Sam, who's one of my students. We just did this literally in my class last week, right? And we use this model to examine female genital mutilation. That's not a topic any of you want me to talk about. I know that. So, but it works when we look at social issues or social action. This can fit into, I do a lot of work in my women's wellness class. We're spending a lot of time talking about abortion. This you can use in education. Like you can look at something like Common Core and you could put it into this model and develop a better understanding. You could look at interactions between, say, union workers and administration. So like teachers, unions, and administration. So this model has lots and lots of uses. But so let me explain to you how it works, and then hopefully, maybe you can start to apply it even to the things that you're doing now, or even in the future. Okay, so what this is telling us is that we all function within an institution, right? So an institution could be like our country, can be considered an institution. This university is considered an institution. Religion could be considered an institution. And within these institutions which we function, we have these rules, these norms, and these resources that are available to us. And so when we look at specific issues, we know that we have actors. These are people who are involved in whatever the social action is that we're talking about. So if we want to, say, keep it with teachers, we could look at, say, teacher union versus, say, administrators. Or we could even look at, say, parents versus administrators or school board or something like that. And then within these institutions, we have to understand the context of where people are coming from. So I do this with FGM when we look at, say, parents who are choosing to have their daughters cut in the context of one institution. And then we look at, say, westernized views in another. Where from like a Western perspective, we see that as a human rights issue. But in a different context of these families who are choosing to do this to their daughters, it's so deeply rooted in tradition and culture based on different rules and different norms that we sometimes can't even conceptualize. And so within each of these institutions, these norms and beliefs that people have, we see this as like an action situation. So these are the people who are interacting with each other. And what we need to understand is that each actor has a few things. One, we all have agency, right? We all have the ability to act and to think on our own. And each actor has their own truth, their own reality, their own beliefs, their own norms, their own morals, their own values, their own ethics that govern the way that they think, that govern the way that they act, the things they say. And until we can understand where that actor and what they're rooted in, it's hard sometimes for us to wrap our head around why people feel ways that they feel. If we wanted to, we could even put like the most recent thing that we've seen happen in this country into this model, which was our election. And we could, you know, sometimes it's really hard to try to understand where the other side is coming from. It doesn't mean that you have to agree. It does not mean that you have to agree with the other side. But it at least gives you perspective of where the actors are coming from. And I think one of the most important things in this model is this concept of communication. And that's what these lines mean. And communication is recursive, right? So there's communication going back and forth. We oftentimes assume that what we say is being heard in the way in which we say it. And that is not the truth when we have two different actors working in two different institutions with different cognitions, motivations, ethics, morals, beliefs. And so sometimes what we need to do is we need to understand that what we're saying is not being heard in the way that we want it to be heard. And sometimes that forces us to take a step back. And by understanding this, it helps provide and to promote better communication. Because what I've learned too, even as an educator, I'll say things sometimes, and I'll get like stare. Like, do you get what I'm saying? Like, it's so clear to me. Or I'll write a test question, and it would be so obvious when I write a test question, and then all of a sudden I'm grading it, and everybody's getting it wrong. I'm like, huh. Or somebody challenges me on it, and I'm like, that's not what it says. And they're like, it's not saying what you say it's saying. And I have to take a step back and go, okay. Because this is what the way I'm thinking about it, how is somebody else thinking about it? And so it forces communication between people. And I think that's so important because so often, that's one of the first things to go in like these kind of action situations, especially when they're contentious. This communication breaks down really, really quickly because we get frustrated because people aren't necessarily hearing what we're trying to say. Maybe we're not saying it in a way that the other person is able to hear or the other actors. And so it also forces us to look at a bigger picture. So just to stay on like the FGM kind of, because I just did it, it's in my head. We can see that sometimes people float in between two institutions. So I think of like NGOs, like non-governmental institutions that are in these areas who are trying to help promote change, but are really able to communicate with communities in a way in which communities understand that doesn't come from like a Western perspective of like, that's a human rights issue and you need to stop. And so sometimes if we can identify these people who are in the middle who kind of like get both situations, it allows for deeper understanding for us too. And then sometimes there's actors kind of like individuals who could be outside of the whole situation. And I think this is really important to understand in education, because when I see reform and when I see change in education, I feel like it fits into this model all the time. And like Common Core is like such a big one, because there's a lot of controversy about Common Core, right? And so like, who is the one who are making the decisions? Where are those decisions coming from? But who's left outside? Who are the ones that are being affected, but really aren't having any voice at all in the situation? And who do you think that is? And keep it in the context of education. Who most often in education is on the outside? The children, right? Our students. And that's a problem. That's really a problem. And so I think too, by recognizing where people fall, where actors fall, it can also help us recognize people who are being disadvantaged, or individuals or actors or whatever we want to call them, who are being affected yet have no voice in these social issues that we're talking about. So I know I must be getting close to my time. But so the challenge is, and my challenge for all of you, not only for yourselves, but for your future teacher selves, is to allow your students, allow yourself to look at both sides of the issue. So I will tell you, so I do this in my classes, and at the end of the semester in one of my classes, we do debates. So I have 2 days of debates, and students have to sign up for a particular topic. So we have everything from legalization of marijuana, youth in Asia, abortion, like really pretty hot topic issues. And so they pick an issue because they're interested in it, but they don't get to decide what side of the argument. You literally flip a coin, perfect, 5 minutes. They literally get to flip a coin and they decide. And I can't tell you how many times students come up to me and they're like, please, I do not want to argue that side. I so believe in the opposite side of the argument. Please, can I change? Can I change? And I'm like, tough loving it. No, you cannot. No, you cannot change. You have to go with the argument that you've been given. And the one thing that I tell students all the time is that it's okay. It's okay to look at the other side. It's okay to see different perspectives. It doesn't mean you have to agree. And what I promise students when they do this is that if they allow themselves to go through this process, if they allow themselves to go through this experience, that they won't necessarily walk away with a complete 180, a complete change of mind, but they will see things from a different perspective. And what they probably will do is have a better, well-grounded, substantiated argument for why they feel the way that they feel. And that makes us all better when we're able to do that. So thank you so much for your time. I know that I'm running out. And are there any questions quickly? Of course not. Like, how many more speakers are there? Right? All right, thank you so much for your time.
Jennifer, that was wonderful. I want to give a round of applause for this. Now, our next speaker tonight, some of you may know him as JQ. His name is Josue Quinones. Now, Mr. Quinones used to be a wrestling director here at BU, and he's now a life coach who inspires and moves and empowers students to pursue their passions to become successful in the future. He is here to talk to us about the path that he took the educator that he is today. Without further ado, here's Josue Quinones in We Never Do It Alone.
How y'all doing?
Good.
I don't know everyone in the room, but I wanted to venture out and ask you all for a favor, if that's okay. Is that cool? Can I ask y'all? It's going to involve some movement. Is that cool? Am I moving a little bit? Yeah? Some people are like, I don't know, it depends on what you're going to have us do. I need everyone to stand. It's pretty easy, I promise. Okay. So, I need everyone in the room to stand with both their hands in front of them. Okay, next step is I need everyone to look as if they won the lottery, as if they just graduated, passed their teaching certification, okay, had the time of their life, or going to Vegas maybe this weekend or something, and maybe somebody's like, ooh. Right? So on the count of three, I'm gonna need you to have the biggest smiles, like it's the happiest time of your life. You're hearing your happy moment, your happy song, your anthem, whatever it is, okay? What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put out my phone and I'm gonna take a few pictures. Cool? Can I do that? Can I do that? Yeah? Okay. Ready? One.
Archer.
Two. Three. Give me a smile. Give me a smile. Love it. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Y'all can have a seat. Some of y'all might be wondering, like, why the hell did he have a stand up and just hold our hands in front? So, there's always this small chance whenever I do a speaking engagement and I'm going totally bombing. And so I have to make sure it looks like I got a standing ovation. So, thank you all for helping me. I appreciate it. So as Russ said, my name is Josue Quinones. A lot of students know me as JQ, and that's totally fine. I'm okay with that. I'm an educator, life coach. I currently work as an academic counselor in the Educational Opportunity Program on campus. I was a resident director at Hinman College for 3 years. I graduated from Binghamton University with a bachelor's in human development, stayed and got my master's of social work. And here I am today. I will start by saying that I would not be here if it weren't for other people, right? And that's the main point that I want to drive home for everybody here, is that we never do it alone. When I got here in 2005, I'm originally from the Bronx, New York. It was my first time away from home. I would imagine like most college students, right? No mom, no dad, no little brothers bothering you, no older siblings, you know, hanging on you. And so it was a rough adjustment for me because nobody tells me what to do. Nobody tells me when to go to sleep. Nobody tells me when I have to go to class. There's like 450 people in like the whole one. I don't know if I'm missing, right? And so naturally, some unfortunate things happen. And I was of the mindset, right, if we refer back to Jen's model, right, I had certain motivators, I had certain understandings, I had certain assumptions. And for me, I felt like I needed to figure this whole college and life thing out by myself. Speaking from a male perspective, it was like, I'm a man, right? I'm supposed to be a man, so you're supposed to be strong. You're supposed to be on your own. You don't have no help, that's good. And so I had this faulty logic. Despite how many people tried to help me, how many people suggested tutoring, despite how many people told me I should see an academic advisor, I did absolutely none of that. I was on the verge of being kicked out. And it wasn't until I got to that point that I started to evaluate myself, right? I said, what the hell am I doing here? Because I'm wasting money, I'm wasting time. If I go back home, I don't think that mom's gonna be too happy about that, right? If I go back home, well, am I going to work at Mondelez Sporting Goods? Probably not, right? Am I gonna join the military? That's an option, right? Nah, right? And that's a noble thing, don't get me wrong. My brother's in the Navy, he's been there 12 years now. And he loves it, he's making a career out of it. And so it wasn't until I reached out to a counselor, I found myself at a point where I was like, I need to do something, and obviously everything that I've tried is not working, so I need to ask someone for help. Prior to getting here, if I'm being honest with you all, most folks didn't think I would even make it to a school like that. I remember specifically I was talking to an academic counselor or college counselor in my high school. And when I told her which schools I was looking at, I told her I was looking at Binghamton. You want to guess what she told me? No. That's essentially what I heard her tell me. Right? I said, you know, I'm really thinking about Binghamton. They have an awesome school of management. I'm thinking I want to do business. Right? And she said, well, to be honest, I think Binghamton is a little bit of a far stretch for you. Maybe you want to apply to some more local schools here. So to me, I heard, no. You won't make it. Funny story is that, and I never advise, I just spoke to a high school group this afternoon from Brooklyn, New York, that came up. I never advise this to anyone, but I only applied to Binghamton. Binghamton was the one and only college, hands down, that I applied to. And thankfully, I got into that. I have no freaking clue where I would be. Right? I was terrified. My mom thought I was crazy, and I was. Fast forward, it wasn't until I reached out to a counselor and finally asked for help that I realized that's what I needed to do all along, right? And if it wasn't for that person, I wouldn't be here. I can't tell you how many times I sit in my office and I'm talking to students and I think of him every time. Because he saw past all that, you know, machismo, all that bravery, all that ridiculousness that I had when I first got here. And despite all the things that I had done leading up to that point, he still helped me out, right? He saw past all of that. And mind you, I will say there were some things that I'm not necessarily proud of. And he knew it. But at the end of the day, he saw something that at the time I couldn't see. He saw past all of that. And as educators and future teachers, I think that that's essential and crucial, right? It's been talked about by Jen, it's been talked about by Andrew. Everyone's gonna have a certain experience that they come with. And it's gonna be tough, right? Because sometimes we just go with what we see in front of us. And it takes a lot of effort, it takes a lot of care, it takes a lot of empathy, sacrifice sometimes, to be able to go a little bit past what we see in front of us and really get to understand someone and know where they're coming from, why they're behaving and acting the way that they do. And until we understand that, we can't necessarily get through to them. Right? I could be sitting here talking to you all day. But if at some point I don't take the time to get to know you, I don't take the time to connect with you on a level that's just past the surface, then I reduce the chances of even getting through to you. Even a little bit. Right? Because I know that there's going to be schools and classrooms where the students will act out, slam stuff on the floor, throw their papers, right? Break pencils, ignore you, just walk out. I may have done that a few times myself. But we have to look past that, right? And try to understand what's driving that behavior, right? What causes it? What's going on at home, possibly? What did they bring into the classroom this morning that maybe they couldn't leave at home? And can't leave at home? To some extent, that happens to you all here, right? There's times when you're in class and you can't focus on it because you got a call from your mom about your brother or about your sister or about grandma, right? And you're sitting in class and the professor's at the front of the room trying to teach you a formula or some concept, and you're on your phone because you're texting your mom or you're texting your brother, or you're on Facebook because you're trying to get in contact with your family because you can't focus. Those are the same things that teachers have to pay attention to. I have to pay attention to. When I meet the students in my office, they come in with registration. I need to find this class. I registered 11:15 at 3 o'clock. Okay, let's take care of that. But how are you doing? How's family? Right? Because it's more than just the classroom. That's just one piece of us. Right? That's just one institution. Our family is another institution. Our friend groups are another institution, if you will. There's rules and regulations and dynamics. And so it's up to us and every one of us as educators to see past that. And if someone hadn't saw past my physical presence, hadn't seen past my actions and my history, I probably wouldn't be here today. And I always credit my success to them. Right? I want to do a little bit of an activity. Is that cool?
Yes.
I want to make sure I don't lose folks, so I like to keep people engaged. I need everyone to lift your left palm out to your side like this, open. Perfect. Some folks who know me in the room know exactly what I'm about to do. So don't spoil it. I need you to take your right index finger and place it in the palm of the person to your right. If you don't have anyone to your left or your right, you're just at an advantage. You know, that's just the way things happen. You're up, you're sat in a spot that maybe the advantage is. So, here's what we're going to do. On the count of three, you're going to try to grab the person's finger in your left hand without having your finger grabbed on the right. Alright? Everybody's looking at each other. Ready? So on the count of three, you're going to try to grab the finger in your left palm, right? You're going to try to grab the finger in your left and move yours on the right. Ready? One. Don't cheat it. Don't cheat it. One. Two. Usually like, for? Right? I need to get out of here. And now, I don't want you to necessarily answer the question, but think about it. Who are you in the moment? Which person were you? You don't have to answer that, but just think about it. Now, more importantly, who would you want on your team? Right? Who would you want on your team? Because chances are, if you were that first person who was super excited, right, and ready, and really energetic, the people around you probably got energized, and if someone else was around you and they got energized, and you got more energized, now you want to compete, right? And you're like elbowing them, don't chicken, I'm watching you, you chicken. But if you were that first person who was super excited, and you were around the second person who was like, yeah, this is dreadful, you may have like, oh, I guess this is coming, right? And so that's something that you have to think about. Because as instructors, as educators, as teachers, one, the energy that we bring into the room is the energy that we receive, right? But taking that a step further is we have to be able to look past that. Chances are that second person really had something to do with it, just go, right? Right? So you can just take it like, see, you're just killing my vibe, killing my energy. I should have set up with it. Like, that's the more fun side, right? But there may have been something going on for that person. Maybe that bio test, you know, they got a D in the last two, and this third one, they gotta get an A, it's not, right? Pass, fail, withdrawal deadline pass, so they can do something. That's a real thing, right? So we have to be able to look past what we see in front of us and extend the hand and show love, show compassion, aim to understand one another, and be a part of that team. Because someone did it for me, and so I just aim to be that for someone else. Why not? Right? I'm pretty sure each and every one of us can think of at least one person in our life that has helped us to reach this very point. Whether it was a parent, a teacher, an instructor, a counselor, a friend, a guardian, a mentor, somebody, some way, somehow has helped us get to this very point. So why not be that for somebody else? As educators, you have the opportunity to be that for students. So the EOP program is the Educational Opportunity Program. It is a state-funded program. And what that program does is it provides additional support and services for students who come from financially disadvantaged backgrounds, because what the research shows is that in districts and areas that have marginalized finances with respect to their districts and what have you, right? When these areas aren't provided the right resources in terms of finances, the students usually don't have the best academic attainment, right? Because they can't afford the books, they can't afford the teachers sometimes, so the teachers are stretched real thin, and so they don't perform the best, right? But there's still a potential for them to succeed if they just got a little bit more push, a little bit more assistance. I myself am a product of the Education Opportunity Program here. I know there are some of them in this room, right? And so, what the Education Opportunity Program does is certain students, when they apply for financial aid, they will mark off a box for EOP, and they will check to make sure that they fit within a certain financial guideline, because EOP does require a financial range, which you have to qualify for, as well as an academic range. And the academic range tends to vary depending on the institution. And so if they fall within that financial guideline, and they meet the academic guideline, then the school will admit them and provide them with some additional services. So the Education Opportunity Program here, we require our students to attend a mandatory summer program. And during that summer program, it's our way of helping them in their transition to Binghamton. So they take some classes, they live on campus, and it really exposes them and tries to help establish some of those foundational aspects of being successful here in college. While they're here as a student, they're just like any other student. They live in the same classes, they live in the same residence halls, right? The only difference, if you would, is that they have a space where they can get some additional support that they need, And so they're each assigned to a counselor, myself, and I work with them, not only in their academic schedules, but also in their personal life. We might talk about some financial aid throughout their 4 years while they're here. Thank you. Sometimes I forget. Any other questions? I'm happy to stick around. I always forget to bring business cards, but I'm more than happy to give folks my email, tell you where my office is, connect, talk about anything, so do not hesitate to approach me. Thank you.
Actually, I'm going to ask for one more round of applause, please. Now, our next guest today is a junior year at BU, Daniel Pressman. And he is here to talk about how schools have become widely organized. Now, many of you probably don't know what that means. Don't worry, he's going to explain it. And so the bottom line to Daniel is that in order to free our education system and our children, we must abolish the education system. So with that, Daniel Pressman here in Austin Schools, freeing education.
Albert Einstein, Henry David Thoreau, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, Mark Twain, Plato, Noam Chomsky. These are some of the greatest thinkers in human history, but today I'm not interested in what they accomplished over their lifespan. What I'm interested in is what they thought about schools. So I want you to keep this question in your mind over what these greatest thinkers had in common, and how they felt about schools, and hopefully, by the end, it will be apparent. So I have two main points that I want to get across today. The first point that, as I was introduced, that in order to free our children and free education, we must not reform schools, but abolish them. The second point is that, you know, if schools are abolished, what are the alternatives, and why do these alternatives hold promise? So, you know, keep you guys engaged as well. I want everyone to close their eyes. I'm going to list off a series of characteristics, and I want you to try to imagine in your mind the institution that I'm describing. This institution, you can't not be there. You can't decide when to leave. In most cases, people don't want to be there. You have to be there for a certain amount of years. The food sucks. There are various programs to help you once you're released. It's an authoritarian structure that it operates under. You walk in lines, your freedoms are abridged, there's a loss of individual autonomy, and someone else decides when you walk, when you talk, when you eat, and when you engage in recreation. Now, you can open your eyes, and I think it's pretty obvious that the institution that I'm talking about is schools. Now, this may be a little surprising to some of you, because it seems like what I was just describing has a lot in common with another institution in prison. And that's not supposed to be the way it is. I mean, our schools are our most cherished institution, and our prisons are our most coercive. We put people in prisons, we hold them captive. We break them down with negative reinforcement, and sometimes we send them back out to society where they're all too likely to end up right back there in the prison. So how could that have so much in common with our schools, which are supposed to free the mind, to push forward our future, as so many of our other speakers have said? How can we look at this? How can this be a nightmare for so many Americans? But this is the American dream. How can this be a symbol of captivity, a symbol of abridged freedoms? But this is a symbol of freedom and play. How can this scare us, frighten us? But this and this makes us feel safe. How does that make sense? These two institutions aren't supposed to have so much in common, but, you know, so many people say, all right, it's coercive. Schools suck. You know, it's a necessary evil. How else are our children going to become adults? How else will they acquire the skills that we want them to acquire, that they need to acquire to be functioning adults in our democracy? My next 2 points prove that they're not even doing this. There was a study done about a decade ago at Lawrence Hill Academy, one of the best boarding schools in the nation. And what they did is they had their students take their finals like usual, and they averaged out the grades. The grades came out to a B+. It's to be expected. You know, it's a great boarding school. The students were prepared. But what they didn't tell them was after the summer, they were going to give them a very similar final exam. The teachers decided to take off low-level questions because they didn't expect their students to still remember them. The average was an F. In 3 months, our A+ students went to failing students across the board. There was not a single student who averaged a passing grade across their finals. What this means is the difference between our failing students and our A+ students is not nearly as much as we thought. The difference is that the failing students don't know the information 3 months before our A+ students. We ruin lives over grades. We track kids into prison via the prison school-to-prison pipeline because they don't know information 3 months before someone else. The second point is that there was a study done by the American Association of Colleges and Universities a couple of years ago, and they conducted a survey. What the survey found was that roughly 2 in 3 students thought they were ready for the workplace, but only 1 in 3 employers. So if we hold this survey to be true, what it shows is that what schools actually do is they're really, really good at making students think they're learning, making students think they're acquiring skills, making students think they're ready to go into the workplace, but employers, not so much. It seems that there's a gap between what's actually happening, what other people without bias are seeing, and what students are feeling. But there's more to schools. There's got to be more to schools, right? It's not just about what we learn and what we remember a couple months later, or what we remember in adulthood. It's about so much more. I mean, we know about summer learning loss, and all of you can relate. I mean, as adults, or pretty much adults, you know that you don't remember a lot of the information from the schooling system. We can all relate. I mean, how many of us would pass our high school finals, let alone our middle school finals? But there's supposed to be more to education. We're exposing children to stuff, right? We're exposing them to the things that we value. And that's what curriculum is. That's people saying, you know, we value this stuff. We've been around for a little while. We want our children, we want the next generation to value this stuff as well. But the issue is, in wanting them to value this, we're imposing it on them via a power dynamic. And what this does is turn them off to the very information that we want them to value the most. By saying, you have to learn this, and you have to learn this in this way, and this is what you have to get out of it, we're distracting them from how great the information actually is. I mean, this may not apply directly to all of you, but I'm sure we can all relate to the parent that, out of all goodwill, forces their child to play a sport or take up an instrument at a young age. And say, that child, maybe they liked playing the violin or playing soccer at first, but you fast forward a decade, and a lot of that joy seems lost in many cases. And for a lot of people, when they turn 18, they want to be as far away from a soccer ball and never want to pick up a violin again. Yet in schools, what we do for 12 years with our children is exactly this. We say, we like this, we want you to like this, and it's out of good intentions. But we turn them off to that very information, and what we're doing more so than anything else is ensuring that when they're 18, they are less likely to engage with the information we want them to engage with the most. Children are people. Adults don't like having other people control their lives. We need to be better for our children. We need to not impose ourselves, our interests, our beliefs, our dreams on them, because it backfires. It does. I mean, just look at the rise in bullying, in mental health disorders, in suicide, in the rise in learning and emotional behavioral hyperactive disorders, the rise in childhood obesity and sedentary lifestyles, and even in school shootings. I mean, these are not separate issues. Maybe it's time to start thinking of these issues as symptoms of a larger disease, and that disease is schools. So at this point, maybe you're saying, all right, schools suck. Let's burn them down. But what's the alternative? Is there anything else out there? I mean, schools are how almost everyone in our society gets educated. What I'm here to talk about is that schools are education. In fact, schools are only a small subset of education. Education is much broader. Education transcends. Education is learning. Learning is life. If you are living, you are educating yourself. You can't separate the two. And people have recognized this throughout history. People have treated children in a way where they just let them live. There are various models that apply to this. Just let children live. No forced learning whatsoever. Let them live. They will learn. They will educate themselves. It could be unschooling, learning centers, community centers, and given time constraints, what I want to talk about today, my favorite, the Sudbury model. So what all of these have in common is they respect the child. The human is a learning animal. We like to learn, and we do it damn well when people don't get in the way. All these models, they really respect children. They let them do whatever they see fit as long as they're not hurting another individual. Specifically with the Sudbury model of education. The first one was originated in 1968 in Framingham, Massachusetts, and it's been operating ever since. And it spread to an international community, along with dozens of states throughout the country. And what this model is based off is a non-compulsory, open campus, self-directed learning, self-governed community, where children are allowed to do as they please all day, every day, all the time, until they leave. There are no tests, there are no grades, there's no homework, there's no curriculum, there's no classes, there's no classrooms, there's no grade levels, there's no teachers. Pretty crazy, right? But children, according to extensive follow-up studies, 85% are going to college. And the 15% that aren't, are not going to college because they can't. It's because they don't want to. We impose college on people. It's not for everyone. Not everyone wants to go into a profession that entails college, and these students realize that. Yet the majority still do. There's two, at the original model that was founded in 1968, there are now 250 students aged 4 to 19. There are no grade levels, it's age mix. They're allowed to interact all day, every day, however they seem fit. There's 12 staff members, everyone gets one vote. All rules in the school, which are few and far between, only made to ensure civil liberties are protected, are equalized. I mean, everyone has one vote, the four-year-old and the staff member that's been for 50 years. And the way the staff members are hired is at the end of every year, the children, not the adults, decide who stays. They vote if someone is going to stay or leave at the end of every single year. There's no such thing as tenure. It's up to the children. A staff member could put everything into the school. The founders could put everything into the school for 60 years, and the children decide to vote them out 1 year, and they're gone. No questions asked. I mean, this model is just so radically different from everything we know. So I want to tell two stories to make it seem a little more human. The first story is titled The Fishing Story. It was a child, Dan, who had the privilege of going to this school, or this model of education, this community, since the age of 5. And his dad was extremely worried because for about a decade, all he did was fish. I mean, all he did every day, seemingly, was fish. And at the end of every year, he would come in and go to the founder and say, holy crap, that kid is just fishing all day. Fall, winter, spring, all he's doing is fishing. How is he going to be an adult? I mean, how is he going to function in life? And at the end of every year, the founder would reassure him, would tell him the same story, the same spiel. Your child, Dan, is doing okay. He's the happiest kid in the community. Everyone loves him. He knows more about fishing than anyone I've ever met in my life. And he knows the intricacies of all the different species, their habitats, their ways of life, the environments they live in. He could grow up and be a fantastic fisherman. He could grow up and go into biology. He could do whatever he wants because what he's learned is to follow his interests and pursue them as passionately with all of his energy that he possibly can. And what's likely to happen is one day that passion for fishing is going to fade away and be replaced by something else. And sure enough, when he was 15, he found out about computers. and he became obsessed. At the age of 16, he was working as a service expert for a local firm. By 17, he and two friends had established their own successful company in computer sales and service. By 18, he had completed the Sudbury model of education and had gone on to study in college. He had saved enough for tuition and expenses all on his own. Throughout his years at college, he was employed as a valued expert at Honeywell, one of the best engineering firms in the world. And he went on to live a successful life. The second story I want to talk to you about is called the math story. It'll be a little more comfortable to you guys because the kid wasn't fishing all day. So what happened was, there's no coercion at these schools. If a child doesn't know how to read, doesn't know the basics of math, no one intervenes. There's no coercion, there's no pushing towards, you really should learn how to read. Here's some books, here's some math, it's super cool, you should learn it. None of that. So a dozen children ages 9 to 12 came up to the founder one day. And what you can do in the Sudbury model is, if you're interested in something, it's not just up to you to teach yourself, but that's the way it goes about it first. And if you're struggling for whatever reason, you can seek out resources. Whether that's staff members, whether that's other children, they could be younger or older, as long as they possess the information that you want. Or it could be the internet. And so what these dozen students did is they sought out the founder. They said, or a staff member, sorry. And they said, you know, we really want to learn the basics of math. None of us know math. Can you help us? And he says, sure you want to know math? This is not your parent telling you you should know math. And what happened was amazing. The children said, no, we want to learn math. Please, please. And so they decided to set up a class with rules. You're allowed to do this. It's not a class. It's not compulsory. You're not bound by anything. If it's not working for the teacher or the student, everyone can leave. And what they decided, they drew up a contract. And what they said was they were going to meet two times a week, half hour each day, for 20 weeks. And what they accomplished in that 20 weeks was amazing. They learned 8th through 8 math, stone cold. 9 to 12-year-olds, a dozen of them, that had never been exposed to formal math in their life, learned K-8 math, something we spend 8 years just killing kids with, that they end up hating it for the rest of their lives. And they learned like that, and they learned happily and with joy. And then they stopped learning math, and they just went back to whatever they were doing until it became interesting to them again. I mean, this is incredibly powerful. This changes the way we just think about the world in general. I mean, the 21st century skills that are so often thrown around in educational reform says we want independent, critical, creative problem solvers that can follow their interests. And, you know, it's not viewed as work, but it's viewed as play to them. And this is exactly what this model entails. And all the other models of unschooling, learning centers, community centers. It's respecting the child to the full extent as a full and autonomous person. That their interests matter, no matter what they are, and the most important thing is to follow your interests, become an expert problem solver, maintain that natural intrinsic motivation, and you will be okay, because you can transfer those skills to anything. What's super interesting about this model is not everyone was, like Dan, able to go there from the second they started their education when they were young, at age 4 or 5. Some people have really bad experiences in public school or private school. So they had to adjust, they didn't know what to do. It takes an adjustment. I mean, to go from a highly structured, even in some progressive schools, there's still lots of structure, to somewhere where it's up to you what to do with your day is a hard adjustment. And so what was found in all these years of operating these models of education, these communities, was that the students, the A-plus students who transferred in, took a lot longer to adjust than the rebels. The rebels who were kicked out, who were told that they weren't succeeding, that they said, please get out, you're expelled, go somewhere else, please. They were pushed into the Sudbury model because that was all that was left for them. And they adjusted seamlessly because there was nothing left to rebel against. All those arbitrary rules that just seemed like, why are they there, were gone. You were allowed to lead your life as you pleased. But for A-plus students, that was super hard, because the life they were leading was for someone else. They were doing what someone else wanted them to do. They were always doing something to please someone else, not what they wanted. I mean, at other schools, you can like what you do, but that's different. That's entirely different from doing what you like. Liking what you do means that someone or something was imposed on you, but you like it. You know, you like it, you enjoy it, and that's not a totally bad thing. But doing what you like is totally different. So, I can do whatever I want, and this is what I'm choosing to do. It's an entirely different sentiment. Why this model of education interests me so much is because here, children are more free than anywhere else in the world. There's no one pushing you, coercing you, even implicitly in a certain direction. It is up to the child to determine how to live their life. Something that not even adults, in many cases, are able to do. And I know this may seem crazy. I mean, we're not used to it. It's not normalized. We've normalized schools. This seems crazy just because it's not normal. In some cases, it may even seem like a heavenly or a utopian type of education. It seems like, how could this possibly exist on Earth? I mean, there's no way this could work for everyone. But the reality of the matter is, this type of model isn't just for some, it's for all. We learn to accept structure. We aren't built with structure. That picture that you saw of that baby, babies are the best learners in the world. They don't need structure. We teach people to need structure. And in teaching that, they become used to it and internalize it and eventually think they. But you don't. We are all intrinsically motivated. Learning was an evolutionary development to help people survive in their environment. We want to learn. We need to learn. And we're craving. We just need to let people do it and get out of the way. While being there, if they seek us out. So if there's a chance that this heavenly or utopian view of education works and is possible, and it can work for everyone, no matter their situation, because you can have as much structure or as little structure as you want in this model. Should we be trying it? I mean, it's heaven or it's utopia, but this is on Earth. We should be seeking this out. We should be, I mean, I'm not guaranteeing that this would spread, but the results are unbelievable. We need to be taking more notice of this. So in ending, I want you to go back to that. Oh, here are just some pictures of Sudbury Valley. Scroll through them. And I want you to go back to these guys. What did I say at the beginning? What did they have in common in how they viewed schools? Well, it turns out that they all hated school. These are some of the greatest thinkers in history, but they hated school. They thought schools and schooling was a bad way to get an education. I couldn't agree more. We just internalized it. Now, educational reform is such a popular term. It's thrown around all the time, but this is the wrong term. We're having the wrong conversation. As we get caught up in the debate between public, private, or charter, or progressive, traditional, project-based, or a mix of all those, we forget a crucial option in none of the above. What I'm calling for is not education reform, it's an education revolution, a revolution of historic proportions to fight back for our children's lives, not to put them back in the hands of adults, but for the first time, to put them in the hands of the children themselves, to live their own lives. What I'm calling for is a revolution of the people, and that revolution starts with you. Thank you. Maybe some questions. Please, I have a resource sheet with tons of information on alternative education that anyone can take if they want, in case they don't want to ask a question right now. Please, any questions? Yeah, so I think the schooling system is totally corrupt, and I think it should be abolished. But I don't believe in federal mandates. If there was a federal mandate to implement these schools, I would say no. That's why I called for a revolution of the people. It has to be the people that call for this, or else the model won't work. Because you can't go home and say, oh, they're doing nothing at this model, so we're going to school them at home. That can't work, because that defeats the purpose. So what I want to do, I want to work outside the system. And I want to work in these models in education, whether it's unschooling or Sudbury model. I basically work there as a staff member, right on the side, try to advocate for them, do some speaking on them. People just don't know that this exists. It seems heavenly, it seems utopian, it doesn't seem like it exists on Earth, let alone for 50 to 100 years. I mean, so just working in these places, I can't rationalize working in schools. It seems like prison to me. Even though the people that work in schools are fantastic people, it's the institution that's wrong. If you're anti-war, you're against war, not people who go fight war. You're against what war is about. So I'm against schools. I'm not against people that go into schools. It's people with incredibly well intentions that just haven't, they don't know of alternatives. So that's what I want to do. Rob.
Now, our last speaker of the night is a person named Aaron Blunt. Now, Aaron is a professor here at BU that specializes in literacy in the graduate school of education. She is here to talk to us about what education has done for her life and taught her within the bounds of the classroom and without. So without further ado, please welcome Aaron Washburn teaching what teaching has taught her.
Wow. So I literally just came from research methods. I teach a doctoral class in educational research methods, so I'm going to do a little mind shift here, a little code switching. Y'all know what that's all about. Daniel, interesting, got the tail end of that. I am one of those people that worked in the school system. And actually, I have been in education for nearly 20 years. Currently, I am an assistant professor, or associate now. Got tenure last year. Associate professor of literacy education. I have worked with people from 18 months old to 65 and everything in between in the past 20 years. And let me tell you, it has been a ride. So my head talk or what I want to share with you today is what that teaching experience and what my teaching experience is now here at Binghamton continue to teach me. So on the tail end of Daniel's, mine might be a little kind of fluffy, but honestly, I hope you hear with the sincerest heart that it truly has been an experience as a teacher. It's been more about learning and less about teaching. So teaching has taught me quite a bit. I want to sort of the first side. It's a lot, and you can sum it up in a warm, cheesy, fuzzy word, right? Lots of L words. No, it's actually taught me some very specific things, and I'm going to take a couple of those L words, and I'm going to expand on them, and hopefully you'll go there with me. And when I talk about teaching, I don't define it in a traditional sense. I think of teaching as any space, any context, where there are ideas exchanged and learning has occurred. So that could be a one-on-one conversation between you two sitting up here, right? Or that could be in a classroom, a lecture hall. It could be in a doctor's office. It could be in any context in which ideas are exchanged and the two folks are willing to listen to one another and learn from one another. So the first thing I learned from teaching is that it taught me how to laugh. Now, do any of you know what that is? Yeah, that was a piece of technology in my classroom when I started teaching pre-No Child Left Behind. Mr. Archer, do you remember that?
Yes.
Remember it well, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And if you didn't have, it's an overhead projector. And if you didn't have your spray bottle to wipe off your overhead projector marker, guess what you had to use? Yeah, right? It was disgusting. And you could always tell who was a teacher at the supermarket by who had green or blue thumbs, right? So this was my piece of technology when I started teaching, an overhead projector. Now this, okay, that's funny because it's really dated, but that's not really why that taught me how to laugh. My first year of teaching, I taught in a small rural school in Texas. And I mean small, meaning that there were no stoplights, there was a Dairy Queen, so there's always somewhere to go for lunch, right, on in-service days. But I taught this tiny rural school where everybody knew everybody, and I lived 30 miles outside of that town. And let me tell you what, I was an outsider. I was for sure an outsider. But I wasn't so much an outsider that I didn't figure out things pretty quickly. One thing I figured out was that there was this infamous family within the town. Infamous, meaning that there were several cousins and several, there were just, it was the Vela family, let's just put it that way, the Vela family. And if you've ever read the best Christmas pageant ever, you have read about the Herdman family. Well, the Herdman family were quite like the Vela family. The Vela family were full of energy, full of life, and oftentimes full of mischief. Well, one day, it was my very first day to be done, or to have an off day, let's put it that way. I felt done because it was December. But it was my first off day, and I had to create sub-plans. Now, creating sub-plans is kind of a scary thing. Because as a teacher, there's this sort of notion that you have control, but you really don't. You don't have control. And that's actually what's kind of cool about it, is you don't have control. But I thought I had control. And creating my first sub-plan, we were reading this novel, To Kill a Mockingbird. Yeah, I see some smiles. I see some, like, yeah, right? You all read it. Ninth grade English, right? I was a ninth grade ELA teacher, right? And I assigned this for my students to do round robin reading. Round robin reading. That's where you get the first page, you get the second page, you get, you know it, right? There's no research to support that practice, by the way. It's like not a lick. It's like the worst practice ever, right? Why is it the worst practice ever? Because what are you going to read? Page one, page two, page three, right? Like you're going to read what you've been assigned and then you're going to check out the rest of it, right? You're going to think about what you're going to do this weekend. You're going to think about anything but the novel, right? Or maybe not. I assigned that for the sub plans. I thought, that's brilliant. Low prep, it'll be easy for the sub. Well, when I came back to my classroom that following Monday after my break, I found that my piece of technology was bubble wrapped. Why? What happened? Why is my piece of technology bubble wrapped? My principal meets me at the front door of my classroom. He says, "Aaron, I'm sorry about that bubble wrapped overhead over there, but Jeremy Vela, he killed it with the Kill a Mockingbird." Now, wait, what? They revolted the sub. They revolted. They hated the sub plan so much. Jeremy Vela chunked this book. It's the same one. He chunked it, threw it at the overhead. The thing blew up, y'all. Like, blew up. And when I got there, I thought, oh, what am I going to do? My whole plans were built around my overhead projector. And I had a choice. I could laugh, or I could get angry. I could laugh, or I could start blaming kids. I could laugh, or I could quit, right? But these things, this is a normal thing that happens to teachers all the time, right? Maybe not their overhead blowing up. But you're faced with the opportunity to either give in to stress and to give in to the hard stuff that happens in the context of school, the hard stuff that happens in the context of your day, or you can laugh. I chose to laugh, and I chose to keep this. And I keep it on my bookshelf in front of me in my office to remind me when I feel stressed out to laugh. You know why? Because laughter, scientifically, is some of the best medicine, right? So teaching has taught me to laugh, and I guarantee you, that was my first year teaching. I've been laughing a lot since then, right? Teaching's also taught me to learn from my mistakes. Now, one of the things, the misnomers of teaching, is that you go to school, you sit through 4 years of preparation to become a teacher, and then after you sit through your preparation, you go do student teaching, and you try it out for a little while, and then, bam, you get your first teaching gig. And for some reason, we have this expectation that teachers then need to know everything that they need to know in order to be successful. and in such a way that we're going to measure that, right? We're going to measure student growth by how well teachers do, and it can be really intimidating, and it can create an environment of sometimes fear, and it can create an environment that failure is not an option. But instead, I've chosen that failure, just like my really crappy, let's call it what it was, sub-plans of thinking that this was going to entertain my ninth graders for an entire class period, round robin reading with the sub. I thought, oh, that's a good plan. That's a great plan. That instead of saying, well, you know what, it's Jeremy Bayla's fault. If Jeremy Bayla weren't in my class, I wouldn't have to deal with this. But instead, I took a step back and thought, wait, hold on. What can I learn from my overhead blowing up? And what can I learn about my instruction? I threw that lesson plan together in no time. Did I think about my students' needs? Yeah. Did I think about efficiency? Yeah. Did I think about Jeremy Bayla? No. So I had an option. I could either begin again, but next time more intelligently, stop and think about what my students needed. I was a fork in the road, right? And in many instances as teachers, it's easy at that fork in the road to either kid blame, family blame, blame society, blame the world. It's much harder to redesign my instruction. It's much harder to research my methods to see, are the practices I'm using not only interesting and motivating to my students, but are they sound? Sound practices. So teaching has taught me to learn from my mistakes, because I didn't want a kid blame. I didn't get into teaching the kid blame. I got into teaching the kid inspired. The last thing that teaching has taught me to listen. Now, which I know is kind of the opposite of what I'm doing right now, which philosophically I struggle with. I really struggle with that idea, right? I believe this. Anybody know this guy up here? John Dewey, right? John Dewey. John Dewey's the father of progressivism, or the father of progressive education, I should say. John Dewey believed that learning only occurs when ideas are exchanged and in the context of social, like in learning is a social process. Learning is not about me coming up on stage and dumping what I have in my head to you and saying, job is done. But rather, he said, learning happens by experience. Think of the best classes you've ever taken here at Binghamton University. Chances are you were an active participant in your learning. Think about your best classes or your best teachers in high school, middle school, elementary school, maybe pre-K, maybe you can go back that far. It's when you were involved and you were hands-on and the teacher listened. That's what teaching has taught me, is to listen, to take a step back and realize that who I'm working with is so much more brilliant than I am. I mean, individually, we're pretty darn smart, right? Collectively, brilliant. And 20 years later, do I still believe that? Absolutely. One of the cool things I get to do every summer is I get to teach a course in literacy assessment and teaching for secondary students. And I have graduate students take that course. And in that course, you get to work with eighth graders who are transitioning into ninth grade. These eighth graders are, quote unquote, deemed at risk. They might be at risk because of maybe poor performance in school. They may be deemed at risk because teachers are concerned about their mental and social and emotional well-being. They may be deemed at risk because they just don't quite fit the mold, right? They're deemed at risk for various reasons. I get to work with them every summer in this program, this class, and in this program, where we, for 4 weeks, You know what we do? We ask them a question. We use a project-based learning approach. John Dewey approved. We ask them a question. What makes your community stronger? You know what, as teachers, we get to do? We get to sit back and we get to listen. Now, don't get me wrong, there's some guiding on the side, for sure. There's some facilitating. There's some making sure that experiences are hands-on. Because good teachers don't just step back and not interact at all, right? Good teachers interact, but they do so in meaningful ways, and they know when to listen. So this group right here, on July 21st, they went to student wing. Oh, no, not student wing. They're in lecture hall two, so maybe you've taken a course there. And they presented their ideas about what they felt makes their community strong. They didn't just present, oh, this is what we think makes a community strong. They presented what they're going to do to strengthen their community. And even more exciting is in October of this year, they did many of those things that they presented. So what teaching has taught me, it's taught me to laugh at myself. And it's also taught me to learn from my mistakes. And it's also taught me to listen. We have this skewed, I think sometimes, vision or even version of what we think teaching is. And what I've learned in almost two decades, almost 20 years of being a teacher, is that I believe that teaching has taught me more than I could ever teach. So my challenge for you today, as you sit in here, probably heard all sorts of wonderful, amazing, challenging things. Let's face it, mine is a little cheesy and fluffy because I'm kind of cheesy and fluffy. But my challenge to you is, as you explore education, as you explore this idea of teaching, I mean broadly, remember, teaching anything, any exchange of ideas, where I'm learning from you, you're learning from me. I want to challenge you. What will teaching teach you? Questions?